Hello all, welcome to Vinod Kumar YouTube channel. In this video I am going to make the chapter number 3 of class 8. The name of the chapter is Ruling and Countryside. The company becomes the Dewan on August 12, 1765. The Mughal Emperor appointed the East India Company as the Dewan of Bengal. The actual event most probably took place in Robert Clive's tent, with a few Englishmen and Indians as witnesses. But in the painting above, the event is shown as a majestic occasion, taking place in a grand setting. The painter was commissioned by Clive to record the memorable events in Clive's life. The grant of Diwali clearly was one such event in British imagination. As the company became the chief financial administrator of the territory under its control. Now it had to think of administering the land and organizing its revenue resources. This had to be done in a way that could yield enough revenue to meet the growing expenses of the company. A trading company had also to ensure that it could buy the products it needed and sell what it wanted. Over the years, the company also learned that it had to move with some caution. Being an alien power, it needed to pacify those who, in the past, had ruled the countryside and enjoyed authority and prestige. Those who had held local power had to be controlled, but they could not be entirely eliminated. How was this to be done? In this chapter we will see how the company came to colonize the countryside, organize revenue resources, redefine the rights of people, and produce the crops it wanted. Revenue for the company. The company had become the Dewan, but it still saw itself primarily as a trader. It wanted a large revenue income but was unwilling to set up any regular system of assessment and collection. The effort was to increase the revenue as much as it could and buy fine cotton and silk cloth as cheaply as possible. Within 5 years, the value of goods bought by the company in Bengal doubled. Before 1865, the company had purchased goods in India by importing gold and silver from Britain. Now the revenue collected in Bengal could finance the purchase of goods for export. Soon it was clear that the Bengal economy was facing a deep crisis. Artisans were deserting villages since they were being forced to sell their goods to the company at low prices. Peasants were unable to pay the dues that were being demanded from them. Artisanal production was in decline, and agricultural cultivations showed signs of collapse. Then in 1770 a terrible famine killed 10 million people in Bengal. About the need to improve agricultural if the economy was in ruins, could the company be certain of its revenue income? Most company officials began to feel that investment in land had to be encouraged and agriculture had to be improved. How was this to be done? After 2 decades of debate on the question, the company finally introduced the permanent settlement in 1793. By the terms of the settlement, the Rajas and Taglakdars were recognized as zamindars. They were asked to collect rent from the peasants and pay revenue to the company. The amount to be paid was fixed permanently, that is, it was not to be increased ever, in future. It was felt that this would ensure a regular flow of revenue into the company's coffers and at the same time encourage the zamindars to invest in improving the land. Since the revenue demand of the state would not be increased, the zamindar would benefit from increased production from the land. The problem, the permanent settlement, however, created problems. Company officials soon discovered that the zamindars were in fact not investing in the improvement of land. The revenue that had been fixed was so high that the zamindars found it difficult to pay. Anyone who failed to pay the revenue lost his zamindari. Numerous zamindaries were sold off at auctions organized by the company. By the first decade of the 19th century the situation changed. The prices in the market rose and cultivation slowly expanded. This meant an increase in the income of the zamindars but no gain for the company since it could not increase a revenue demand that had been fixed permanently. Even then the zamindars did not have an interest in improving the land. Some had lost their lands in the earlier years of the settlement, others now saw the possibility of earning without the trouble and risk of investment. As long as the zamindars could give out the land to tenants and get rent, they were not interested in improving the land. On the other hand, in the villages, the cultivator found the system extremely oppressive. The rent he paid to the zamindar was high and his right on the land was insecure. To pay the rent he had to often take a loan from the moneylender, and when he failed to pay the rent he was evicted from the land he had cultivated for generations. A new system is devised by the early 19th century. Many of the company officials were convinced that the system of revenue had to be changed again. How could revenues be fixed permanently at a time when the company needed more money to meet its expenses of administration and trade? In the northwestern provinces of the Bengal Presidency, most of this area is now in Uttar Pradesh. An Englishman called Holt McKenzie devised the new system, which came into effect in 1822. He felt that the village was an important social institution in North Indian society and needed to be preserved. Under his directions, collectors went from village to village, inspecting the land, measuring the fields, and recording the customs and rights of different groups. The estimated revenue of each plot within a village was added up to calculate the revenue that each village, mahal, had to pay. This demand was to be revised periodically, not permanently fixed. The charge of collecting the revenue and paying it to the company was given to the village headman, rather than the zaminder. This system came to be known as the Mohalwari settlement. The Monroe system in the British territories in the south. There was a similar move away from the idea of permanent settlement. The new system that was devised came to be known as the Yatwar, or Yatwari. It was tried on a small scale by Captain Alexander Reed in some of the areas that were taken over by the company after the wars with Tipu Sultan. Subsequently, developed by Thomas Monroe, this system was gradually extended all over South India. Reed and Monroe felt that in the south there were no traditional zamindars. The settlement, they argued, had to be made directly with the cultivators, riyats, who had tilled the land for generations. Their fields had to be carefully and separately surveyed before the revenue assessment was made. Monroe thought that the British should act as paternal father figures protecting the riyats under their charge. All was not well. Within a few years after the new systems were imposed, it was clear that all was not well with them. Driven by the desire to increase the income from land, revenue officials fixed too high a revenue demand. Peasants were unable to pay, yats fled the countryside, and villages became deserted in many regions. Optimistic officials had imagined that the new systems would transform the peasants into rich enterprising farmers. But this did not happen. Crops for Europe. The British also realized that the countryside could not only yield revenue, it could also grow the crops that Europe required. By the late 18th century, the company was trying its best to expand the cultivation of opium and indigo. In the century and a half that followed, the British persuaded or forced cultivators in various parts of India to produce other crops, jute in Bengal, tea in Assam, sugarcane in the United Provinces, now Uttar Pradesh, wheat in Punjab, cotton in Maharashtra and Punjab, rice in Madras. How was this done? The British used a variety of methods to expand the cultivation of crops that they needed. Let us take a closer look at the story of one such crop, one such method of production. Does color have a history? Two images of cotton prints. The image on the left, figure 5, shows a Kalamkari print created by weavers of Andhra Pradesh in India. On the right is a floral cotton print designed and produced by William Morris, a famous poet and artist of 19th century Britain. There is one thing common in the two prints. Both use a rich blue color, commonly called indigo. Do you know how this color was produced? The blue that you see in these prints was produced from a plant called indigo. It is likely that the blue dye used in the Morris prints in 19th century Britain was manufactured from indigo plants cultivated in India. For India was the biggest supplier of indigo in the world at that time. Why the demand for Indian indigo? The indigo plant grows primarily in the tropics. By the 13th century, Indian indigo was being used by cloth manufacturers in Italy, France and Britain to dye cloth. However, only small amounts of Indian indigo reached the European market and its price was very high. European cloth manufacturers therefore had to depend on another plant called woad to make violet and blue dyes. Being a plant of the temperate zones, woad was more easily available in Europe. It was grown in northern Italy, southern France and in parts of Germany and Britain. Worried by the competition from indigo, boed producers in Europe pressurized their governments to ban the import of indigo. Cloth dyers, however, preferred indigo as a dye. Indigo produced a rich blue color, whereas the dye from boed was pale and dull. By the 17th century, European cloth producers persuaded their governments to relax the ban on indigo import. The French began cultivating indigo in street dhoming in the Caribbean islands, the Portuguese in Brazil, the English in Jamaica, and the Spanish in Venezuela. Indigo plantations also came up in many parts of North America. By the end of the 18th century, the demand for Indian indigo grew further. Britain began to industrialize, and its cotton production expanded dramatically, creating an enormous new demand for cloth dyes. While the demand for indigo increased, its existing supplies from the West Indies and America collapsed for a variety of reasons. Between 1783 and 1789, the production of indigo in the world fell by half. Cloth dyers in Britain now desperately looked for new sources of indigo supply. From where could this indigo be procured? Britain turns to India. Faced with the rising demand for indigo in Europe, the company in India looked for ways to expand the area under indigo cultivation. From the last decades of the 18th century, indigo cultivation in Bengal expanded rapidly and Bengal indigo came to dominate the world market. In 1788, only about 30% of the indigo imported into Britain was from India. By 1810, the proportion had gone up to 95%. As the indigo trade grew, commercial agents and officials of the company began investing in indigo production. Over the years, many company officials left their jobs to look after their indigo business. Attracted by the prospect of high profits, numerous Scotsmen and Englishmen came to India and became planters. Those who had no money to produce indigo could get loans from the company and the banks that were coming up at the time. How was indigo cultivated? There were two main systems of indigo cultivation, Nij and Ryoti. Within the system of Nij cultivation, the planter produced indigo in lands that he directly controlled. He either bought the land or rented it from other zamindars and produced indigo by directly employing hired laborers. The problem with Nij cultivation: the planters found it difficult to expand the area under Nij cultivation. Indigo could be cultivated only on fertile lands, and these were all already densely populated. Only small plots scattered over the landscape could be acquired. Planters needed large areas and compact blocks to cultivate indigo in plantations. Where could they get such land from? They attempted to lease in the land around the indigo factory and evict the peasants from the area. But this always led to conflicts and tension. Nor was labor easy to mobilize. A large plantation required a vast number of hands to operate. And labor was needed precisely at a time when peasants were usually busy with their rice cultivation. Nij cultivation on a large scale also required many plows and bullocks. 1 biga of indigo cultivation required 2 plows. This meant that a planter with 1,000 bigas would need 2,000 plows. Investing on purchase and maintenance of plows was a big problem. Nor could supplies be easily got from the peasants, since their plows and bullocks were busy on their rice fields, again exactly at the time that the indigo planters needed them. Till the late 19th century, planters were therefore reluctant to expand the area under Nij cultivation. Less than 25% of the land producing indigo was under this system. The rest was under an alternative mode of cultivation, the Ryoti system. Indigo on the land of Ryats. Under the Ryoti system, the planter forced the Ryats to sign a contract, an agreement, sata. At times, they pressurized the village headman to sign the contract on behalf of the Ryats. Those who signed the contract got cash advances from the planters at low rates of interest to produce indigo. But the loan committed the Ryat to cultivating indigo on at least 25% of the area under his holding. The planter provided the seed and the drill, while the cultivators prepared the soil, sowed the seed and looked after the crop. When the crop was delivered to the planter after the harvest, A new lawn was given to the riad, and the cycle started all over again. Peasants who were initially tempted by the loans soon realized how harsh the system was. The price they got for the indigo they produced was very low, and the cycle of loans never ended. There were other problems too. The planters usually insisted that indigo be cultivated on the best soils in which peasants preferred to cultivate rice. Indigo, moreover, had deep roots and it exhausted the soil rapidly. After an indigo harvest, the land could not be sown with rice. The Blue Rebellion and after in March 1859 thousands of Riyats in Bengal refused to grow indigo. As the rebellion spread, Riyats refused to pay rents to the planters, and attacked indigo factories armed with swords and spears, bows and arrows. Women turned up to fight with pots, pans and kitchen implements. Those who worked for the planters were socially boycotted, and the gomistas, agents of planters, who came to collect rent were beaten up. Riyats swore they would no longer take advances to sow indigo nor be bullied by the planters' lathaiyals, the lathi-wielding strongmen maintained by the planters. Why did the indigo peasants decide that they would no longer remain silent? What gave them the power to rebel? Clearly, the indigo system was intensely oppressive. But those who are oppressed do not always rise up in rebellion. They do so only at times. In 1859, the indigo Riyats felt that they had the support of the local zamindars and village headmen in their rebellion against the planters. In many villages, headmen who had been forced to sign indigo contracts mobilized the indigo peasants and fought pitched battles with the lathaiyals. In other places, even the zamindars went around villages urging the Riyats to resist the planters. These zamindars were unhappy with the increasing power of the planters and angry at being forced by the planters to give them land on long leases. The indigo peasants also imagined that the British government would support them in their struggle against the planters. After the revolt of 1857, the British government was particularly worried about the possibility of another popular rebellion. When the news spread of a simmering revolt in the indigo districts, the lieutenant governor toured the region in the winter of 1859. The Riyats saw the tour as a sign of government sympathy for their plight. When in Barasat, the magistrate Ashley Eden issued a notice stating that Riyats would not be compelled to accept indigo contracts. Word went around that Queen Victoria had declared that indigo need not be sown. Eden was trying to placate the peasants and control an explosive situation, but his action was read as support for the rebellion. As the rebellion spread, intellectuals from Calcutta rushed to the indigo districts. They wrote of the misery of the Riyats, the tyranny of the planters, and the horrors of the indigo system. Worried by the rebellion, the government brought in the military to protect the planters from assault, and set up the Indigo Commission to inquire into the system of indigo production. The commission held the planters guilty, and criticized them for the coercive methods they used with indigo cultivators. It declared that indigo production was not profitable for Riyats. The commission asked the Riyats to fulfill their existing contracts but also told them that they could refuse to produce indigo in future. After the revolt, indigo production collapsed in Bengal. But the planters now shifted their operation to Bihar. With the discovery of synthetic dyes in the late 19th century, their business was severely affected, but yet they managed to expand production. When Mahatma Gandhi returned from South Africa, a peasant from Bihar persuaded him to visit Champaran and see the plight of the indigo cultivators there. Mahatma Gandhi's visit and